My name is Fred GARDAPHÈ, distinguished professor here at the Calandra Institute, and I will be chairing the session and ruling that time very strictly. Our first speaker is Dr. Leonardo BUONOMO. Teaches American literature at the University of Trieste in Italy. His research interests include 19th century American literature, Italian-American studies, and American popular culture. His most recent book is Immigration, Ethnicity, and Class in American Writing, 1830-1860. And just last year, a year and a half ago, Reading the Stranger, which came out in 2013. His talk is entitled Escape from Modernity, Francis Hodgson's Burnett's Italian Children, and
good afternoon. Francis Hodgson Burnett is best known as the author of such children's classics as Little Lord Fauntleroy and The Secret Garden. And because of the phenomenal success of Little Lord Fauntleroy, she was able to travel extensively. And Italy became one of her favorite destinations. And when she set foot in Italy, it was practically love at first sight. Or perhaps in her case, one should add at first hearing because of the sheer delight she took in the sound of the Italian language. This is particularly evident in a letter she wrote from Florence in 1887, in which she bitterly complained to a friend about an unauthorized stage version of Little Lord Fauntleroy, and peppered her text with words such as figuratevi, accidente, brutta bestia, madonna mia, o signore, and ended it with addio, illustrissimo signore. Unlike many other British and American writers in Italy, she made a serious effort to learn the language and also had her two sons take Italian lessons. And during her 1887 stay, she hired a young Italian woman, Luisa Chiellini, as a companion, secretary, and language tutor. Chiellini became an important member of Burnett's household and lived with Burnett for several years. Italy continued to grow on Burnett in the following years, to the extent that in 1904, she described it as the most adorable country in the world. In Italy, she was particularly captivated by the local children, especially the urchins who dug the steps of well-to-do foreigners such as herself, or those who sang beneath hotel windows. Her observations of and contact with Italian children provided her with inspiration for some of the stories she included in her books, Giovani and the Other, 1892, and Piccino and Other Child Stories, 1894. With a romantic, idyllic rendition of Italian scenes, Burnett may be said to have followed in the tradition of many 19th century English and American culture travelers who, in countless travelogues, poems, stories, and romances, perceived Italy as a land still unspoiled by modernity, a sort of Arcadia where one could take refuge, albeit temporarily, from the ugliness of fast-increasing industrialization and urbanization. Seemingly removed from once busily modernizing society, Italy, as James Buzzard has noted, could be shaped into a vessel for deferred wishes and experienced as the country that possessed the greatest concentration of the valuably different in Europe. Crystallized in a pre-industrial rural past, Italy was a land in which local children were believed to be a key component of the picturesque, the comforting aesthetic category Italy's foreign visitors invariably evoked in their descriptions. Burnett's fascination with young Italian street performers also aligns her closely with such American writers as Herman Melville, Lydia Maria Child, and Nathaniel Hawthorne, who, by introducing organ players and other wandering musicians into their works, called attention to the early phase of Italian immigration to the United States. Some of Burnett's Italian children have much in common with Carlo in Melville's Redburn, or the nameless musicians in Child's Letters from New York and Hawthorne's The House of the Seven Gables. Indeed, reading Burnett's story, Giovani and the Other, which revolves around two street singers, is like reading about Melville's Carlo or Child's or Hawthorne's street performance before their departure for the New World. Like Melville, Burnett created in Giovani and other Italian stories a sort of literary equivalent to the celebrated Spanish painter Murillo's famous portraits of poor children. Like Murillo and Melville, Burnett aestheticized poverty, turning it into a spectacle for the consumption, from a safe distance, of middle-class American and English readers. Like her illustrious predecessors, she composed portraits in which enchanting children, especially boys, with abundant curls, invariably bright dark eyes and long lashes, wearing frayed peasant costumes, produce a pleasing effect which often borders on the erotic. Obsessed with physical beauty, Burnett at times suggests a female Lewis Carroll. Burnett's Italian children are embodiments of beauty, innocence, and simplicity, blissfully untroubled by their low economic condition and the consequent disadvantages. Reading about their adventures, Burnett's readers could thus bask in the reassuring fantasy representation of social inequality, that same abysmal difference in the distribution of wealth that in the streets of New York or London met their gaze on a daily basis in all its brutality. The book Giovanni and the Other was published in England under the title Children I Have Known, which, like the subtitle of the US edition, Children Who Have Made Stories, alludes to its partly autobiographical source. In a preface, Burnett draws a parallel between her own creative process and that of a visual artist. When an artist looks at things, scenes, and people, they form themselves into pictures. Similarly, under her gaze, they form themselves into stories. It is a telling analogy because there is much of the visual in her writing, as we may notice when she describes a real-life Italian child who became story material. And in order to save time, I'm not going to read the long quotation, but you can see them there. So I'm referring to the first one. Begging here is not the symptom of an economically depressed and socially iniquitous environment, as post-unification Italy certainly was, but rather a profession that, like acting, is a performance art and requires the right temperament as well as natural gifts, preeminent among which is physical beauty. Indeed, as seen by Burnett, beauty is an asset which the Roman boy knowingly makes the most of. Reappearing later in the sketch A Pretty Roman Beggar, the boy is described as a professional beggar and a professional beauty, who, though very young, he's only 5 years old, knew perfectly well what an assistance to the first profession the last one was. I am sure he knew, Burnett goes on to say, that he would not have had so many patrons or half so many soldi if he had not been so pretty to look at. Together with the boy's beauty, Burnett emphasizes the foreign, exotic quality of begging to American eyes. Quote, "My little Roman, so far as beauty goes, is one of the most perfect small pictures I remember, and he is chiefly interesting as a study because he belongs to a profession which I think does not really exist in America." Certainly not alone in regarding begging as incompatible with American prosperity, and more importantly, with the American character and the Protestant work ethic, Burnett stands out among Anglo-American visitors for her reluctance to sound the note of moral indignation, which was so common in travelogues and fiction about Italy. More than anything, she's intrigued by the boy's seemingly carefree attitude towards a practice which, she implies, in more advanced countries, such as the United States and England, was deemed debasing and shameful. Quote, "To a stranger, it seems that every Roman child who is not rich is taught to regard begging as a sort of honest industry which any useful infant will cultivate." Burnett's use of the negative form "not rich" in lieu of "poor" sets the tone for a portrayal of street children in which the reality of indigence is essentially denied. As she puts it, they do not look the least uncomfortable or hungry. Having removed from the scene the unpleasantness of need, Burnett can concentrate on the aesthetics of the faces, bodies, costumes, and postures of her young models, the way a painter would. These children are a veritable feast, and not just for the eyes, because taste, sound, and touch are also evoked in Burnett's enraptured depiction. And here's the next quote, the little Roman beggar. The products of a pre-industrial environment and the representatives of a not quite white ethnicity, Burnett's Roman children are of course closer to nature than their English and American counterparts, a closeness which Burnett suggests through her abundant use of animal imagery. The narrator and the little beggar in the first quote equally enjoy their exchange. There is no pang of conscience in the former because there is no hint of social demand or reproach in the latter's presence and manner. That they both experience their exchange as a performance, if not a playful courtship ritual, is confirmed by the boy's parting gesture as he's moving away with a fellow beggar. Quote, he checked his run for a moment and wheeled round, still holding his companion's hand, and with the most graceful little smiling gestures, he threw me a whole butterfly flight of kisses, and his friend did the same. As a friend of the narrator's is quick to notice, no such grace and graciousness could be expected in the then capital of the industrialized world, where inescapable actualities check the impulse to romanticize class inequality. Quote, only a little Italian beggar could do that. Imagine a London crossing sweeper throwing one kisses when one gave him a brown. In the story, Giovanni and the Other, Burnett once again takes inspiration from personal experience, indeed from the most painful episode in her life, but only to leave reality further behind. Told in third person, Giovanni and the Other is set in the resort town of San Remo, where a grief-stricken Burnett recuperated after the untimely death of her older son, Lionel, in 1890. So does her thinly disguised fictional stand-in, a wealthy American tourist who takes an interest in a young Italian street singer whose talent reminds her of her gifted late son. Like many of Burnett's other works, Giovanni is a variation on the Cinderella formula, with the initially humble and socially disadvantaged protagonist undergoing a thorough social transformation, in this case from itinerant performer to celebrated opera singer, thanks to the providential intervention of the fairy godmother-like tourist, who is always referred to as the lady in black. Burnett's boy singer Giovanni is 14 years old, probably named after the 19th century tenor Giovanni Matteo da Candia, who's mentioned in the story by his stage name Mario. The boy is, needless to say, handsome, strong and plump and well-built, with a dark-eyed, pretty face and a gay, bright smile. Both his appearance, he's also dark-haired, and his repertoire, he sings such songs as La Bella Sorrentina in the Neapolitan dialect, strongly align him with the South, even though he's a native of a region located in the northwestern part of Italy. But what to an Italian is definitely the North, to Burnett, in line with other Anglo-American visitors, is the South, at once a geographical and a cultural category. It is the romantic South, blessed with almost perennial sunshine, where the local peasantry, who live according to rhythms unaffected by progress and machinery, are content with what they have and know no real want. Luckier than most, Giovanni possesses the gift of song and puts it to good use by performing for foreign tourists who invariably reward him with handfuls of coins. One would never guess from Burnett's story that Italian authorities looked upon young street performers like Giovanni, both in Italy and abroad, as victims of exploitation, to the point that in 1873, a law had been passed which forbade their participation in so-called wandering trades and punished the adults responsible for that participation with a fine or a jail sentence or both. Nor would one imagine that in most cases, the relationship between the young performers and the adults who had borrowed them from their parents closely resembled that between indentured servants and masters, if not even slaves and masters, and that physical abuse of the children was rampant. Burnett presents that relationship as one of collaboration and mutual benefit. Burnett's most accomplished and interesting literary portrait of an Italian child is to be found in the novella 2 Days in the Life of Piccino, which opens the collection Piccino and Other Child Stories. Set in San Remo and the neighboring countryside, the novella recounts the strange adventure of an exceptionally beautiful peasant boy whom a bored English lady buys from his parents and takes to her villa to be scrubbed clean, decked in expensive clothes, and displayed for her and her friends' amusement. Because of his age, he's not yet 6 years old, and diminutive size, the protagonist is universally known as Piccino, a term of endearment which in Italy is closely associated with children's stories, nursery rhymes, and lullabies. It also calls to mind classic fairy tales such as Tom Thumb, known in Italy as Pollicino. And if the American benefactress in Giovanni can be seen as a fairy godmother figure, the English lady in 2 days suggests an evil fairy, or a not-too-distant relative of Andersen's Snow Queen. Intriguingly, Burnett's novella could also be read as a reversal of the best-known and most widely translated Italian children's classic, Collodi's Pinocchio, with the fairy this time seemingly bent on turning a real boy into a doll. Burnett portrays Piccino as a child of nature, animal-like in the simple enjoyment of his surroundings, and he stays in France, given that his favorite playmate and companion is a donkey. He lives with his numerous family in a small rural town in what would be, in any other country, extremely precarious circumstances. But this is Burnett's Italy, a land which perfectly fits the bucolic pastoral ideal, whose signatures, as Phyllis Bixler reminded us, include a receiving of nature's sustenance with a minimum of work and a holiday from many of life's often unpleasant realities. Accordingly, Piccino lives in a place where, quote, the sun shines and the air is soft and people seem born with a sort of gay carelessness of most things that trouble the serious world. Trouble in this Arcadian environment comes in the form of foreign intrusion, specifically in the guise of well-to-do tourists who choose it as the site of their excursions and lavish picnics. It is during one of these picnics that a young, rich English widow with no children, by the name of Lady Eileen, first lays eyes on Piccino. She had been told by friends of his uncommon beauty and the fact that the other peasant children seemed to use him as a bait to win over the wealthy foreigners and thus get money and food from them. But unlike the other seekers of the picturesque, Lady Eileen is not content with merely contemplating the beauty which is being dangled before her eyes. She must make it her own as she would by purchasing an animal or a precious object. He looks, she tells her friends, as if he had been deliberately made to order, but I would never have had the imagination to order anything so perfect. Technically, Lady Eileen does purchase an animal in the sense that she convinces Piccino's mother to lend her the child, as she puts it, in exchange for buying back the donkey that Piccino's good-for-nothing father had sold to a usurer. So the donkey remains with the family while Piccino is taken away. Now, it is often the case that stories written for and about children are particularly frightening. This is certainly true of the second half of 2 days, in which a dazed Piccino finds himself in a completely unfamiliar world. Indeed, his adventure becomes a tale of terror when, shortly after his arrival at Lady Eileen's villa, he's handed over to her stern maid, Nicholson, to be washed, combed, and made presentable. Even though he does not understand what the maid says to him, because she speaks only English, he senses her hostility. When she takes all his clothes off, and because they're old and dirty, kicks them away disgustedly, he feels disrespected and violated. And when she puts him in a bathtub full of water, he panics and calls his sister's name, fearing for his life. Though not as dramatic as this first bath, Piccino's other experiences in Lady Eileen's villa are very unsettling. In addition to feeling utterly displaced and lonely in the villa's huge, spotless rooms, he's given what to him seems strange, inedible food, and has to suffer the indignity of being put into a girl's frock and sash and lace collar in order to be paraded before Lady Eileen's guests. Given that, except for Lady Eileen, nobody around him speaks Italian, the boy might well be in a foreign country. Indeed, considering that what is done to him is intended to divest him of his identity and make him conform to civilized standards, and that Burnett wrote this at the height of Italian immigration to the United States, Lady Eileen's villa suggests a miniature version of Ellis Island. In Piccino's case, the process of assimilation fails miserably. After refusing to touch the villa's unfamiliar food, Piccino devours the dark bread and garlic-flavored salami that a little Italian girl performing on the villa's grounds with other strolling musicians shares with him. The fragrance of garlic, a fitting symbol of the boy's cultural identity, proves stronger than any bath. For all the maid's furious efforts, it cannot be washed away. An Italian through and through, according to a stereotype with which Burnett's readers would have been very familiar, Piccino replays the slap he received from the maid with a look full of meaning. Ultimately, Piccino proves impermeable to civilization as conceived by Lady Aileen and her entourage, a fact she accepts without much regret when she discovers that he has managed to run away and rejoin his family. Instead of projecting herself into the story, as she did with the narrator in A Pretty Roman Beggar and the Lady in Black in Giovani, Burnett here keeps her distance and treats the wealthy English-speaking tourist mainly as a target for satire. And yet, one wonders whether she also used this character to guard herself against the temptation of too invasive and too physical an intervention into the lives of the Italian children she never tired of watching. Thank you.
Our next speaker is Chiara Mazzucchelli, Assistant Professor of Italian Studies at the University of Central Florida in Orlando. She is the current editor of Voices in Italian Americana. She has published in journals such as the Tom Kang Review, Nuova Prosa, Journal of Lesbian Studies, Italian Americana, and Forum Italicum. Her book, The Heart and the Island, A Critical Study of Sicilian American Literature, is forthcoming with the State University of New York Press, which has a wonderful display here if you haven't seen it. And the title of her talk today is L'America for Children, Luigi Capuana e gli Americani di Rabbato.
This is actually part of my next book project, which is a comparative study of Sicilian and Sicilian American literature on emigration. During the course of the 20th century, living became a significant part of the life of Sicilians. It is easy to understand how the island's finite geography translates into a lack of economies of scale, of resources, and in most extreme scenarios, of access to decent standards of living and quality of life, therefore encouraging emigration. Since the unification of Italy in 1861, all of the aforementioned phenomena, exacerbated by the newborn state's failure to adequately address the different realities of the Italian mosaic, caused Sicily to experience a massive displacement of its people to the United States that resembles that of Ireland during the second half of the 19th century and Puerto Rico since World War II. In his 1963 study, L'Emigrazione in Sicilia, historian Francesco Renda reports that in 1900, about 29,000 emigrants left Sicily, of whom 21,000 left for the United States. Only 6 years later, in 1906, the number of Sicilians living the island had grown to more than 127,000, with 70% of them directed to the New World. The following lines from vernacular poet Domenica Zaretto's 1906, La partenza dell'operaio per l'America, invoke the full extent of the impact that emigration had on the people of Sicily. What confusion in every town, family, and home. Since I started hearing about America, everybody's getting ready to leave. Some prepare their underwear and shirts. The penniless ones mortgage their house. Distressed, they all say goodbye to their families, and off to America they go. Born in 1839 in Mineo, in the province of Catania, Luigi Capuana witnessed firsthand the effects of emigration, especially on the families and communities left behind in Sicily. In his 1912 children's book, Gli Americani di Rabbato, Capuana tackles the topic of emigration and the plight of the Sicilian subaltern classes with the purpose of educating young Sicilian children about the realities and risks of living one's patria or homeland, or in this case, home island. In this paper, we look at how Capuana addresses the issue of emigration by imparting a lesson on the importance of one's roots, while at the same time, he highlights the necessity of opening the eyes of the children to a broader life experience and perspective through education. A poet, playwright, essayist, novelist, and short story writer, Capuana was an early exponent of verismo, a literary movement that developed especially in southern Italy at the end of the 19th century under the influence of French naturalism, which aimed at an objective and authentic representation of the real life of the lower classes. Capuana's 1879 novel, Giacinta, which the author dedicated to arguably the leading figure of French naturalism, namely Émile Zola, is considered the manifesto of the verist movement. But Capuana was also a prolific writer of children's literature, including fairy and folk tales and youth fiction. Some of you might be familiar with Scurpiddu, Gambalesta. These are like masterpieces of Italian youth children, youth literature. But the realistic vein of much of Capuana's novelistic production heavily influenced his 1912 Gli Americani di Rabbato. In this children's book, in fact, Capuana aims to present a truthful picture of the life and aspirations of the poor classes that targets young readers. Realism and regionalism combine to create a sociological and psychological portrait of the life of a turn of the 20th century Sicilian boy. The theories of Merismo infiltrate every aspect of this book. The setting is a precise time period in history, a few years between the end of the 19th century and the beginning of the 20th. And as for the place, to Capuana's own admission, the Rabbato of the title is Mineo, the writer's own hometown. Furthermore, the language of the book is a heavily Sicilianized Italian, as realistic as the forces that causes the characters to think and act as they do. As a school inspector in Mineo, Capuana was very familiar with the difficulty faced by the children at a time and place in which education was considered a privilege for a very few and a waste of time and money for many others. Later, as a mayor of Mineo, Capuana also became aware of the substantial demographic, socio-economic, and cultural changes brought about by immigration. All these preoccupations are reflected in the story of Menu La Manna, the young protagonist of Gli Americani di Rabbato. Menu is a kind-hearted and well-mannered 9-year-old boy, the youngest of the 3 grandchildren of Zisanti La Manna, the 90-year-old patriarch of the family, who lives in the house with Menu, his older brothers Santi and Stefano, and their widowed mother, Gna Maricchia. With his brothers always working in the fields, little Menu spends most of his time with his nonno, Zisanti, who often appears as the bastion of old world values and a defender of the status quo. The old man is especially troubled by his grandson's unhappiness with their life as farmers, which leads them to embrace ideas about social justice and the value of collective action. I'm quoting, "Back in my days," Zisanti explains, "the gentlemen were the gentlemen, and the farmers were the farmers. Now they want the world upside down. No one is happy about their lot," end of quote. But the routine of the daily life of the La Mannas is shaken by the news of the arrival in town of an Americano, and even in the book's title, American is used between quotes. Carmine Liotta, the Americano, also known as Coda Pelata, just came back to Sicily for the first time since he moved to New York a couple of years earlier. The former barber impresses his paisani with a new suit, a nice tie with a big gold tie pin, and several gold rings on his fingers. The return of Coda Pelata sets in motion a series of events that will affect the life of all townspeople, and especially the La Mannas. The Rabbatani, the people from Rabbato, listen with rapt attention to the Americano's tales of plenty of a country where the land, cows, and horses are up for grabs for anyone. Coda Pelata reassures everybody. You might think it's fairy tales, but once you get there, you know, you really need to see it with your own eyes to realize that that's really another world, end of quote. Many Rabbatani quickly decided they will leave Sicily to go with them to New York. Little Menno's older brothers, Santi and Stefano, too, fall for Coda Pelata's propaganda, much to their grandfather's regret. In her article, Emigration et Fierté Nationale, Michela Toppano points out that, quote, "to the grandfather and many others his age, emigration is to be condemned because it upsets the traditional order of things. In fact, they understand emigration as the refusal of the condition that God has assigned to each of us, and therefore it questions the hierarchical principles on which the community has been founded and works. Furthermore, emigration is responsible for the loss of traditional values, end of quote. However, despite his initial resistance, Zisanti, the nonno, has to finally agree to mortgage his house and land to pay for the young man's ticket. Menu, who is too young to live with his brothers, stays behind in Sicily with his nonno and mother. But ever since his brothers left for New York, the boy is secretly obsessed with the idea of migrating to the United States. He has some confused idea about America, which he derives from his school books. He says, it's called the New World, I know. Christopher Columbus discovered it with an egg, he adds, thus confusing facts and fiction. From his books, he also learns, he has also learned about elevated railways and skyscrapers that are taller than the bell tower of Rabbato. Zisanti tries to reason with Manu by emphasizing the importance of one's roots and sharing with them his anti-immigration views. Still, the old man has a hard time controlling the young boy's enthusiasm. The questions of social order and destiny, which are typical themes in the literature of the Verismo, are at the core of this children's book. Zisanti worries about young Menno's future because, unlike his older brothers who were raised to be farmers, like their parents, grandparents, and ancestors for centuries past, Menno has a faint familiarity with the stern realities of a farmer's life. As much as Zisanti does not believe in education as a way to unlock potential in young children, he's also not convinced that Menno would have a better future farming the harsh lands of Sicily. As we can see in a fragment of a conversation that Zisanti has with his old neighbor and friend, Shankatello. Quote, if I had a child, I'd put a hoe in his hands. We're farmers and we have to remain farmers. Some of those who came back from America regret having left, you know? To which Zisanti replies, I don't know if he will adapt. Then, with obvious pride, he adds, he's always holding books in his hands, even now the school is over. He got a silver medal last year, and I think he's gonna get one this year too. End of quote. Torn between his old conservative values and the modern developments of Sicilian culture, Zisanti fears he won't be able to help Manu find his way in this world. The first letter that the Lamanas received from Santi and Stefano seems to suggest that the American dream is in fact attainable with hard work. Written in poor Italian that mimics patterns and structures of Sicilian dialect, addressed as it is alla mano del Signori Santo Lamanna, Rabbato, Talia, Sicilia, the letter is meant to reassure the family that the two are doing well, but at the same time it reveals the cultural shock experienced by the newly arrived immigrants. Quote, don't worry about us. We will make a fortune. But our head is spinning from the number of people who come and go. It feels like everybody's running from the cops and we have to adapt. If it were not for our paesani, no one would understand us because they speak an English language, una lingua inglesa, that it sounds like they're chewing it with their teeth, while our Sicilian language is so practical that it'd be better if they all spoke Sicilian, they say. 200 lire are included in the envelope along with the letter. With this money, Zisanti will later pay off the mortgage. In her article, The Idea of America in Luigi Capuana's Gli Americani di Rabbato, Rita P. observes, quote, America, the magical world, word, seems to banish ideas of toil, poverty, and failure, and symbolized for so many wealth, happiness, and success. That was the popular myth and reality for some. Reality for many, though, was often quite different, as Capuana wished to make clear, end of quote. Bound by the canons of Verismo, Capuana wanted to provide a balanced view of the opportunities and challenges of living in Sicily for l'America. Gli Americani di Rabbato is not an overtly anti-immigration children's book, nor does it represent the American dream pursued by millions of Italians between the unification and 1924 is an easy way to finally reap the rewards of hard work and efforts. In an attempt to provide a comprehensive account of the life of Sicilian immigrants in the States at the beginning of the 20th century, the writer summed up his consideration of the experience of immigration in what seemed to be the only two possibilities for a poor and an illiterate immigrant. One, work hard and earn the respect of the real Americans, and two, join organized crime and earn everyone's contempt. Stefano Lamanna finds a decent job at a rich American banker's farm, where he also befriends Miss Mary Keller, the banker's daughter, who has an irresistible fascination with all things Italian, especially songs and tales. The eldest brother, Stefano, on the other hand, joins the local Mano Nera. Pitt further observes that, quote, for a patriotic writer like Capuana, it must have been particularly painful to admit the criminal activities of some of his compatriots in New York, where the Black Hand was known to be active at the time when the book was written. In fact, Pitt goes on to speculate that the presence of the Mano Nera in this children's book might explain the 3-year gap between the book's completion and its publication. The book was ready to be published in 1909 in Palermo. That same year, New York police officer Joe Petrosino was shot upon his arrival in Palermo, where he planned to investigate the connections between the Mano Nera or between mafia activities in Sicily and in New York City. The murder of Petrosino most likely caused Capuana's editor to push the manuscript to a later publication date. Capuana's uncompromising condemnation of mafia and organized crime in general does not prevent him to depict Stefano as a good man at heart who is driven to crime by sheer vulnerability. As a poor and illiterate Sicilian immigrant, Stefano becomes an easy prey to the Black Hand, which recruits him to extort payments by force. His little brother, Mano, will be one of Stefano's victims. Finally, in New York, Mano finds a job helping his paisano Zicarta with his fruit stand. Stefano tries to convince little Mano to give him some of Zicarta's money, but when the boy refuses, the older brother leaves a menacing letter for the owner, signed with a Black Hand. Zicarta decides to place the matter in the hands of the local police. However, Mano refuses to collaborate. By refusing to bring his brother to justice, Mano is obviously motivated by allegiance to his family and also by a characteristic Southern Italian mistrust for the government and its justice system. But Capuana also seems to suggest that as much as Mano is intrinsically Sicilian in character, he's also endowed with certain qualities that make him a better candidate for success in the United States than his immigrant brothers. Thanks to his, albeit limited, schooling, in fact, Mano manages to find a job as an errand boy for Stefano's philanthropic American banker, and to thrive in his new life, thanks to Miss Mary Keller, who teaches him English. His brother Stefano eventually gets what he deserves when he's stabbed at a bar fight and later arrested for his criminal activities. Because of his detention, Stefano will not be able to make the trip back to Rabbato with his two brothers. After 3 years in New York, Mano and Santi can finally meet again with their nonno and mother. Initially, the brothers plan to return to the United States after a short visit. As Santi explains to Zisanti, Mano's future is safe there. The banker's daughter cares about him. The boy is very serious and responsible. He speaks English. It was a stroke of luck. Mano will succeed. But in a rather expected turn of events, both brothers decide, to everyone's surprise except the readers, that they will never again leave Rabbato. In a fit of patriotism, little Mano proclaims, "I want to be Sicilian, Italian, not a bastardized American. You know what I will do, nonno? I will take a teaching license. I will teach a little Americanism here. The willingness to do things, the great love for work." Which means that from a little over a year of working in the United States, in New York, Mano has derived the experience needed not only for his personal advancement and future career, but also to make a significant change in Sicily's education system. In Gli Americani di Rabbato, the crucial changes brought about by mass immigration intertwine with Capuana's idea of nationalism, which is obviously informed by his own personal experience as a Sicilian boy coming of age during the years that culminated in the unification. Even if the school of Verismo was first and foremost inspired by the canon of impersonalità, according to which the author had to remain an objective observer of reality, it is not difficult to identify Capuana's spokesperson in Dr. Liardo in the book. A liberal but cautious reformist, Liardo refuses the revolutionary theories of the local agitator, but he also condemns the injustices perpetrated by the so-called galantuomini against the farmers. Dr. Liardo, and we can safely assume Capuana himself, views with paternalistic benevolence the emancipation of the farmers and understands the reason that drives his fellow Rabatani to leave everything behind and go to America. However, Dr. Liardo, like Capuana himself, understands emigration only as a temporary safety valve to alleviate economic hardships, but not as a permanent solution to poverty. In conclusion, through the story of Menno Laman and his family, Capuana tackled the issue of emigration within a pedagogical framework with the goal of educating the unwitting children on the issues facing a newly unified Italian nation and the most recent phenomenon of emigration. In the end, Capuana seems to suggest, the only way to improve the conditions of the masses involves the full cooperation of the young generations who need to take responsibility not only for their life, but also for their country. The writer's patriotic feelings, coupled with his faith in education as a means to overcome the adverse effects of poverty and disadvantage, inspired his children's book, which provides us with a better understanding of the social and cultural factors that shape the history of Italian immigration to the United States. Thank you.
Lisa Maria Paolucci is a doctoral student in English education at Teachers College, Columbia University, and a New York State certified English teacher. That's important. I was once the only certified English teacher in a college English department. She currently serves as the program coordinator of the education department at St. Francis College in Brooklyn. In addition, Paolucci was recently elected to the Executive Council of Italian American Studies Association and is a board member of the Italian American Writers Association. Her talk today is entitled Searching for the Culturally Conscious in Children's Fiction with Italian American Characters.
This presentation is called Searching for the Culturally Conscious in Children's Fiction with Italian American Characters. And this is basically an overview of something that I think is turning into a very large project that I'm excited to keep working on. So I'd like to begin by taking you directly into a picture book and then working our way from there. Henry and the Kite Dragon by Bruce Edward Hall, illustrated by William Lowe, was published in 2004 and is identified by the Library of Congress as a work of fiction in which Italian Americans are a major subject. The blurb on the inside cover states the following. Everyone knows that kids from Chinatown don't go to the park when the kids from Little Italy are there. They're rough, they're big, and they don't like Chinese kids. That's okay. Henry doesn't like them either. I hope you can really see the illustrations because they're really beautiful. The story, which is set in 1920s New York City, where Chinatown and Little Italy meet, is told by 8-year-old Henry Chu, whose grandfather makes and flies large, colorful kites. To entertain the children, Grandfather Chin would have his kites appear to chase any pigeons that were flying by, which would then frighten the pigeons away. A conflict arises when Tony Guglione from Little Italy, whose name the narrator instructs us to pronounce Guglione, it's spelled out, begins throwing rocks at the kite until it falls. Hall writes, Tony and his friends tore the kite to bits. They ripped it and stomped on it and shook their fists. The next time the Chinese children and Grandfather Chin fly a caterpillar kite, Grandfather Chin again has it chase the pigeons, which is followed by the Italian children throwing rocks again. This time, Tony makes a kind of lasso, as you can see there, and pulls in the caterpillar kite so that they can all stomp on it. Grandfather's idea to remedy the situation is to have the Chinese children work together on an even larger dragon kite, which the children do not even get to release before the rocks begin flying. The Chinese children, in anger, begin marching toward Little Italy, as Hall writes, down Mott Street, making a right turn at the Catholic Church, marching one short block into the park where Tony and his friends were waiting. Chinese kids never went into the park when Tony was there. This image is what really made me want to start with this book. This powerful portrait of a group of young Italian American boys shows them hurling an ethnic slur at the Chinese children yelling, Ching Chong Chinaman. When Grandfather Chin flies the huge dragon kite in order to gain the attention of all the children and prevent further fighting, and it terrifies another pigeon, we see Tony cry. Hall writes, Great big Tony Guglione actually started to cry. Tony finally explains that the pigeons are his, and Henry, our narrator, recalls, in Little Italy, they kept pet pigeons, homing pigeons, in cages on their roofs. He told me how our kites scared the little birds, and sometimes they flew away and never came back. This moment sparks an understanding between the children, who eventually come to a compromise about when the kites and birds will be flown, and they even allow themselves to enjoy the contributions of the other children. To what extent, I wondered, after reading this book, were other Italian-American characters depicted in this manner in children's fiction? Popular metaphors used to describe the role of children's of literature in children's lives are that literature can be a window into the cultures of other ethnic, racial, or religious groups, and that it can be a mirror of one's own. Because of this understanding, great emphasis is placed on reviewing and evaluating children's books, which has a very practical purpose. Specifically, reviews are used to decide which books get purchased by parents, schools, and libraries, which might ultimately lead to whether or not books stay in print. Children's book reviewers are therefore important gatekeepers. As I explored the reviews of Henry and the Kite Dragon, I expected to find the representation of the Italian children at least mentioned in some degree. Instead, Elizabeth Bush, in her review in the Bulletin of the Center for Children's Books in 2004, refers to the Italian children as a gang of Italian toughs. A gang of Italian toughs. This phrase seemed to ask readers to call up the stereotypical images of Italian Americans that they'd perhaps garnered from popular movies. I read this line with the sense that readers were expected to almost chuckle in recognition of the type of Italian characters these were. Interestingly, Bush notes that this book promotes cultural diversity. Though Bush's point does seem valid, that a close-up dragon, this is her line, a close-up dragon kite in pursuit of a fleeting pigeon impels young viewers to imagine how a benign image in one culture could appear quite menacing in another, I would argue that this theme is accomplished at the expense of the portrayal of Italian-American children without allowing the topic to even enter the conversation. Okay. So the title of this paper, Searching for the Culturally Conscious in Italian-American Children's Fiction, comes from Rudine Sims Bishop's 1982 text, Shadow and Substance, published by the National Council of Teachers of English. Bishop describes her research as a survey and analysis of 150 books of contemporary realistic fiction about African Americans, published from 1965 to 1979, appropriate for young people from preschool through eighth grade. She divides the literature into three categories as after reading the literature. The social conscience books, the melting pot books, and the culturally conscious books. The social conscience books, as Bishop defined them, are geared toward white readers who are being encouraged to develop a social conscience, an awareness of social injustice, and of their responsibility to help make things right. These works focus on racial conflicts, which is assumed to be inevitable in that particular type of literature, and whenever there's a racially mixed social situation. The shortcomings of the social conscience books include the weak characterizations of African Americans, as she describes it, often positioned as exotic or alien, tainted with stereotypes. The melting pot books, as you can imagine, ignore anything other than skin color that might identify the characters as black. Only the illustrations may indicate whether the characters are black or not. The melting pot books fall short in that they seem to hint that differences are undesirable or to be ignored. Most of the melting pot books she found were also written by white authors. Finally, Bishop identifies the culturally conscious books, which are mainly written by African American writers themselves. These books set out to reflect both the distinctiveness of African American cultural experiences, as Sims describes it, and the universality of human experience. They're set in black cultural environments, have black major characters, are told from the perspectives of those characters, and include some textual means of identifying the characters as black, such as physical descriptions or distinctive cultural markers. This study was a groundbreaking response to the aftermath of Nancy Larrick's call for more books about non-white children in her highly referenced article, The All-White World of Children's Books, published in the Saturday Review in 1965. Bishop found that although there had been a great increase in the number of works of fiction for children about the African-American experience by the 1970s, many appeared to perpetuate some misrepresentations from the past, and others represented black characters and black life as they might be seen and understood from an outsider's perspective. The most promising development was the emerging body of children's fiction that reflected African-American cultural traditions, sensibilities, and worldviews. As Bishop points out in her most recent article, published in the Journal of Children's Literature in 2012. In this article, Bishop states that it was not her intention when publishing Shadow and Substance to create a set of categories as a framework for evaluating fiction about other groups. So this was not her intention, but that this has been an unanticipated contribution of her work. She makes specific references to parallel cultural groups or groups who feel themselves marginalized in the larger American society, specifically Asian Americans, Latinos, and gay, lesbian, and queer groups. Her conclusion is the springboard for this study. She writes, children's books from underrepresented groups may tend to follow a pattern, from stories in which they are the exotic other, to stories in which they are assimilated into the larger American culture, to their own stories, told by their own group members, and reflecting their perspective on the world and their experiences in it. I sought to learn whether works focusing on Italian American characters would display a similar pattern, and to be able to identify those that could be considered culturally conscious. I'm going to skip this one for the sake of time. We'll go to this one. Melting pot books, those that nearly ignore the racial or ethnic groups of the characters and depict them as in basically socially equal situations, do not exist for children's stories about Italian-American characters. In books where Italian-American characters are depicted, so if there's some identification that they have this Italian background, in a contemporary setting, the authors always use simplistic and sometimes negative stereotypes of Italian Americans. I did not find any exceptions so far. One title that exemplifies this is D. James Smith's The Boys of San Joaquin, a children's novel published in 2005, which only includes references to Italian Americans in the text through well-known stereotypes. The novel, which revolves around a 12-year-old boy named Paolo O'Neill, growing up in California in a large family, begins with a list of characters titled, Who's in My Story? Immediately, his Italian mother is contrasted with his father, as the father is described as a quiet one, came from Appalachia, while his mother is a genuine Italian lady, never takes sass. He later describes her as Italian, a little woman full of love and hot tempers. As Paolo narrates a story of his youth from his adult perspective, he continues to describe his family members in terms of stereotypical Italian traits. Of his father, he states, he was a giant, over 5 feet, 8 inches. I know what you're thinking, but to my mother's people, that's as big as a giant, because that Italian side of the family, my dad called them the I-Italians, doesn't have one man among them whose head you'd see in a crowd of children. I was walking to the grocery store once with my I-Italian grandpa, and a railroad crossing guard arm came down as we just sailed right under and beat that train. And that was the first time I noticed how I ended up short. At a family dinner described later in the novel when Paolo's Italian grandfather is visiting, Grandpa, described as dark and round as a chili bean, with slick back and shiny hair, comments on his 16-year-old granddaughter's desire to go to a drive-in movie with a male friend, which the author writes out phonetically to evoke the Italian accent. And this is actually uncomfortable for me to try to read the way it's written out. But so the grandfather is written to have said this. If she's 50 and she has a no husband, she don't go nowhere without her papa or her grandpa. In Italy, a boy talked to a girl by himself. Her brothers get a sticks and they talk of that boy themselves. That boy, he no bother that sister no more. Throughout the rest of the novel, Paolo narrates his adventures with new friends, his brothers, his cousin, though his own Italian ethnic background is never represented as integral to his character. It remains simply a way to present a colorful description of his Italian family members, depicted as other. And in his own life, the only remnant of his heritage seems to be his name. Okay. So if we subscribe to the metaphor of children's books as possible windows to other cultures and mirrors of one's own, the significance of the representation of Italian Americans in these works of fiction is so far apparent. Using Bishop's criteria for culturally conscious books, I was able to identify approximately a quarter of the books I read as fitting the majority of the criteria, which are the following. And so she has six specific elements. The first, language. The distinctive grammar, lexicon, and style of a cultural group, when present, should add richness and authenticity to the book without reducing characters to caricatures. 2, relationships between old and young, such as with a grandparent. Focus on the special understanding that develops between the two, with the older person being a teacher or mentor, the younger often helping with some task. The two have time, patience, and love to give to each other, and the result is a warm, close, honest, and satisfying relationship. The 3, extended families. Taken together, the young-old relationships and the extended families speak to a tradition of respect for older people and a traditional awareness of the ties that bind disparate members of those families and communities together. 4, names, nicknames, terms of address are traditional. 5, references are made to historical and cultural traditions and contributions. And 6, there is some reference to religion. Culturally conscious books can also be distinguishable in some cases by a general theme or topic. And so I chose Granny Torelli Makes Soup because it is written by Sharon Creech, who has won the Newbery Medal. This children's chapter book demonstrates that a character who is an Italian-American older woman who likes to cook does not have to conform to a simplistic or stereotypical image at all. Creech, who is herself of Italian descent, uses 12-year-old Rosie as the narrator and places Rosie's argument with Bailey, her best friend, as the central conflict of the novel. From the very beginning, Rosie recounts her grandmother's advice, a woman she describes as so reasonable, so calm, so patient, contrasting her grandmother with, of course, herself. Italian words are sprinkled throughout the novel as a natural part of Granny's language, as exemplified in the following lines. "Ciao, Bailey," Granny Torelli calls out as we come in the door. She says it like this, "Ciao," and it's written C-H-O-W in the explanation. It means both hi and goodbye. I like that little word, ciao. Another example is when Granny Torelli comes over to stay with Rosie while her parents are away and says she wants soup. Zuppa, she calls it. She says it like this, zuppa. The words are clearly explained to child readers who learn not only what they mean, but how they are pronounced. This seems to be accomplished in an organic way, demonstrating that they are well integrated into Rosie's life. Granny teaches Rosie how to make soup and takes advantage of the time together to find out what's bothering her, noticing that she's experiencing some sort of internal conflict, which turns out to be her strained friendship with Bailey. Granny states, "You maybe can fool other people with that smart head of yours, but you can't fool Granny Torelli." Granny begins to tell Rosie a story about a boy she knew in Italy named Pardo, describing his black curly hair, enormous black eyes, a smile like Bailey's, and declaring, "I loved Pardo. I loved Pardo so much. I wanted to be with him every minute, every day." Granny goes on to reveal shameful moments in her own experiences as a child and teenager, including one where she cut another girl's hair off because she was jealous. As Granny draws parallels between her experiences with Pardo in order to empower Rosie to solve her own conflict, the preparing of the meal continues. "What kind of salad?" she asks Rosie. "The one with oranges," Rosie replies. "Eccola," she says, already rummaging in the refrigerator, gathering 2 oranges, some parsley, searching in the cupboard for olive oil. She hands me a knife. We slice. There's a sense of wholeness throughout the novel in which Italian foods, terms, and names are embedded in Rosie's everyday life, and especially through her relationship with Granny, a dynamic character who demonstrates a possession of agency in her own life. Rosie's respect for her grandmother is revealed when she states, "I wish I had all the things in your head inside my head." These elements make Granny Torelli Make Soup a fair example of a culturally conscious work of fiction. And I hope we have time, but I'll go fast. So Fire at the Triangle Factory, a 1996 publication by Holly Littlefield, is an example of what might be a social conscience book for Italian Americans. It focuses on the fire at the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory, 1911. Written for children ages 7 and up. It's a transitional reader, and you can tell on the pages by the white space, the large font. Fire at the Triangle Factory focuses on Minnie Levine, a 14-year-old Jewish sewing machine operator whose parents were from Poland, and Tessa, an Italian Catholic girl of the same age with the same occupation. We follow Minnie out of the Jewish neighborhood on Saturday, where the streets are empty due to the observance of the Sabbath, although the Triangle Factory is open, and Minnie must appear for work. The narrator recounts Minnie and Tessa's early days at the factory, when they were only 10 and had to physically conceal themselves when an inspector visited the factory, thus revealing the labor conditions of the time when child labor laws were not enforced. We also learn of the length of the workday, which included over 8 hours of work, and Minnie's knowledge that her papa would be angry if he knew Tessa was her friend. Papa grew up in Poland. A Jewish girl could never be friends with a Catholic girl there. The bond between Minnie and Tessa is revealed in the illustration of Tessa's Italian neighborhood, bustling on a Saturday, vibrantly colored. The two girls intent on socializing on the way to work. The description of the factory is as overcrowded, but the revelation of the necessity of the girls' employment there for the support of their families both contribute to making this a work of social conscience. Littlefield does not spare children from the horrifying details of the fire. So there are the families. She notes the inadequate size of the elevators, the locked doors, the women who found their only way out to be jumping out of the windows. Minnie and Tessa manage to escape as Minnie's dress catches on fire and Tessa puts it out, ending up with only an ankle injury. The story continues to fulfill the descriptions of a social conscience book as it ends by focusing on the division between the two religious groups. Minnie tells her father that she cannot leave Tessa injured without help, knowing that he had told her over and over not to go to the Italian neighborhoods. He had told her not to speak to any Catholics at work. His response is what she expected. I'm sure some of her own people can help this girl. Minnie's father finally relents when he learns that Tessa actually saved Minnie from the fire, and he carries her home, the story ending on a satisfying positive note. As William Heckman's School Library Journal Review notes, readers are left with the feeling that these young women may have taught their elders a lesson. Fire at the Triangle Factory and other works that highlight injustices in, okay, I'm gonna stop here. You sure? Okay. The conclusion is basically that although I found many works of that I would call culturally conscious, what most puzzles me, and I think is really the project here, is how to deal with works that are considered socially conscious works that we could consider, when in fact many of the details of Italian American history are not as well known, and so they might play a different role for us, perhaps. But to be continued. Thank you. Thank you.
This question is for Lisa. Lisa, I have two questions. The first is, have you noticed any trends in the more egregious examples of, you know, race of this kind of racism in the publishing houses? You know, because you have to wonder how these books get to be published.
Right.
That's question number one. Question number two, have you considered contacting an author such as the one of the Boys of San Joaquin to start a conversation, to try to figure out how such racism, what year was that book published?
I believe that was early 2000s, 2003.
So there's
yes.
really no excuse for it.
Right, so that's what I would say. First of all, I only found about 60 books, children's books, works of fiction only. I didn't look at memoir. With Italian American characters, which felt like a lot and feels like a lot, but it's nothing in the the large amount of books that have been published, and the newest books, aside from Granny Torelli Makes Soup, do seem to still include these little stereotypes. And one of the ones that I skipped over was about a Korean boy adopted by an Italian American family, and he has to do a project on tracing your heritage. So he goes through the struggle. What is my background? And the parents are described with just the same, in the same way. And this is a book that is still in print. But I thank you for that suggestion. And it's something that I should do to start a conversation with some of the authors. Thank you.
I'd like to ask two questions. Chiara, is Luigi Capuana's work been translated? Is it available in English?
No, absolutely not. Especially the Americani di Rabbato. Yeah, his work in general, yes. Some of his work, yes. But his youth, no, absolutely not. And especially the Americani di Rabbato.
Yeah.
Absolutely
the one
not.
That's very interesting
no.
to me.
Some of his work, because again, he was the leading, well, he was, chronologically speaking, he was the leader of Verismo. Because his Giacinta, which was his first novel published, and dedicated to Emile Zola, was chronologically the first novel in the Verist movement. However, he was kind of obscured by Verga, who is the Verist, writer per excellence. So some of his work has been translated, but his youth books, and especially gli Americani di Rabbato, absolutely not.
Thank you. Lisa, I'm interested to know, you've spoken about novels. I'm very interested myself in picture books and early images and visual images. Are there any books that fall into that culturally conscious category that are considered picture books?
There may be a couple of the oldest books that I found that I would have to look at again that might fit that description, but maybe I could think of maybe one. But I would have to look at it again.
Okay. Maybe I can talk to you afterwards.
Absolutely. I also, say it again. I'm not sure about that one, but I do have a list that I would love to share and
yes.
with whoever would like. Yeah.
Thank you.
So that'd be great.
I'll talk to you after.
Thank you.
Hi. I guess I have a question for all of you about sort of the genre of children's books and what they can and cannot tell us. And I think in all cases there's this sort of the politics of the author are leading in their depiction of a reality. The Capuana is sort of anti-immigrant feeling, and yet he is known as a realist, and that's he's the leader of that. The Burnett's sort of aestheticization of poverty obscures us really from seeing maybe Italy at that period in some ways. And then, you know, even this triangle book, which you know, Jewish, Italian sort of ethnic harmony, but, you know, it obscures looking at that incident as a indictment of capitalism or something like that. And so how do we use these kinds of sources to get at a kind of a complex social reality when the politics of the artist and the writer is so important in
Well, in the case of Capuana tries to give a balanced view of immigration in his novel. However, it's very obvious. He was not really anti-immigration per se. He was anti-immigration in the sense that he didn't see it as a solution, especially permanent. Immigration was not a solution at all to him. What he thought was that immigration was wonderful because it could open, you know, Sicilians' eyes to what's going on, you know, on the other side of the world. However, they were supposed to come back and implement what they had learned, you know, in the U.S. Only in this way they could, you know, help improve the conditions of the local farmers, of the local children, and everything else. But let's remember, Capuana was born in 1839. He was 21 years old when the unification took place. He was, you know, it was important for him. It was important for him. He was also actively, involved with the process of unification at a local level for the city of Mineo. But still, it was very, very important for him. So it's impossible to take that, you know, from the book, obviously.
Thank you. In the period in which Burnett wrote these books, there was a lot of anxiety in England and the United States about the rapid pace of industrialization and the sort of the ugliness of poverty in urban centers such as London and New York. And so Italy came to be seen as a possible alternative, as a land yet untouched by modernity. This is something that you see in a lot of books by English and American writers of that period, to the point that they deliberately left out what did not conform to this vision, because of course we're talking about years post-unification Italy, when Italy was engaged in a major effort at modernizing and tried to conform to the standards of the rest of Europe, especially of Northern Europe. So it was a sort of selective gaze. One of the few writers in this period who was aware of the problematic aspect of this kind of representation was Harry James. There's a There's a beautiful passage in his transatlantic sketches in which he describes Venetian children, very poor children, and he's on the one hand fascinated by the beauty of these children. He says the famous painter would have killed to have one of these children as models, but at the same time he realizes that there's something disturbing in the fact that he's enjoying the spectacle and that these children are suffering. There's no pretense, it's real poverty.
Evidently there's a difference in literature books and in textbooks, because I'll be presenting tomorrow on Italian textbooks, because with textbooks there are many guidelines and regulations on presenting the other, on bias. My question mainly is for Leonardo. In Italy, are you seeing there be an emphasis put on how the others are presented in Italian youth children's books?
I think that I'm not really familiar with recent Italian children's books, but it seems to me that very often there is a lack of awareness and sensitivity. While I was listening to Lisa's very, very interesting talk, I was thinking of the fact that I grew up with a very popular series of children's books that they came with 45 records, so you could look at the illustration and listen to the story. And these books have been reissued many, many times. They're still in print. And they are based on classic fairy tales. And there's one of these stories, it's Italo Calvino identified it as one of the few authentically Italian fairy tales, uniquely Italian fairy tales, which is called The Three Pomegranates, or The Three Oranges, depending on the version. But so in this version for children, the villain in the story is a black woman, and the way she's portrayed in this book is incredibly offensive, extremely racist. Well, the book has been reissued many, many times. It's now again in print and being advertised. And nobody that I know of has ever made a comment about the fact that maybe this particular story should come with an explanation or with a warning or something. So I find this very, very, very revealing of a lack of awareness. Okay.